This is BBC Two, where for the first time, BBC Television and Radio One bring you a whole weekend of exclusive coverage of Glastonbury with John Peel and Joe Wiley.
I'm John Peel.
And I'm Joe Wiley.
And we're at the Glastonbury Festival in this Bedouin tent, which has been constructed really as a tribute to the important part the Bedouin culture has played in popular music over the years.
And we're here, not really blending in very well, looking like something, I don't know, a pair of extras from Waiting for Godot or something.
And the theme of this event, of course, so far has been mud. And it's good British mud at that. And there have been muddier festivals. There was one at the in the hills above Buxton in 1969. Unspeakable, unimaginably terrible. This is as nothing by comparison.
I have to say, this is like nothing I've ever been to in my life or particularly want to go through again. This should give you a rough idea of the festival so far.
Well, as you can see, there is a great deal of mud, some of it airborne, and I've been out just to check, you know, to see if there was any grass out there, and researchers, you know, the programme, you have to do a certain amount of research, because I've been doing stuff for Radio 1 and also looking after my children as well. 117 blades, I counted in
total.
It was
probably AstroTurf or something like that, someone was hired in. Okay, the first band that you're going to see today were introduced on stage by Dennis Pennis. They were described as the best Prodigy tribute band you'd ever seen, the Australian Prodigy. Here they are.
Thank you. The Prodigy there, lively little blighters, and as you can tell, we're doing this programme live and cold, and people occasionally slop by in the mud at the other side of the fence, and somebody's just shouted at me to say hello to his Auntie Catherine in Holyhead. Hi, Catherine.
But she only listens to your radio show.
Oh, see. Anyway, as far as I know, things have gone very well during the day on the main stage.
The story on the other stage, though, was completely different. Rumours had it sinking beneath the mud at one point. Bands were turning up in the morning to be told they wouldn't be needed. Kinnicky were in tears. Well, they were pouting anyway. This is Jane Middlemiss and Jamie Thixton's report.
It's Friday afternoon and the mud has taken its first casualty here at Glastonbury. We're on the other stage. Kinnicky should be playing, but as you can see, there's no one playing at the moment. This is because the stage is in fact...
And put them in the camper van with us.
Yeah, the lovely camper van is.
How is your Glastonbury 97 experience going?
Stop!
Can you say on
this? No. Total disaster.
Not swearing. What's happened?
It's a sort of calamity with a twist. A disastrous twist.
That's well, personally, I'm mud for it.
Mud for it, that's the phrase.
Mud for it.
There was rumours flying around that the stage was sinking.
We hope to get the show on the road by about 5 o'clock this evening.
Well, that's good news.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So all the major bands will be on tonight.
Yeah.
So we've lost a few bands this morning, unfortunately, but we're down in sorting out with safety people now. The engineers are running about getting all the bits and pieces and getting sorted out, you know, it's a bit of a shame.
Well, nobody seems to know where we're supposed to go, and the stage seems to have gone down, the second stage, but it might go up again. It might become unsunk.
Glastonbury 97, muddy fun or bloody terrible?
Well, bloody terrible for us because obviously we've just heard that the second main stage has just literally subsided into the mud and all the bands so far have been cancelled, including ourselves, which is unfortunate. But we're just at the moment trying to see if we can, we've got our full orchestra here, so we're seeing if we can maybe do an impromptu acoustic set with all the violins and stuff, which could actually be quite nice.
Now, we've just spoken to the health and safety people. The stage is okay, it's safe. It hasn't rained for a while, and the barriers have all been mended, and my life story are due to kick off here any minute now.
Well, we finally did it. We managed to play at Glastonbury. We've had a lot of work with the backstage staff. They've cleared the way. We're just going to do an acoustic set because half the band have gone home, haven't they? So
we will play Glastonbury.
We will do it against all the odds.
Good bloke that Jay Shinningford out of my life story. I've just been doing a spot of DJing on the second stage and I introduced Ash, who are very good indeed, and what are those lads called?
Seahorses.
The Seahorses, and they were very good too.
These bands never ever look the same. This is like you're seeing bands in the raw when you see them doing these reports, don't you? Anyway, the band that did actually get to headline on the other stage were this lot. Kind of local lads, stretching it a little bit, but this is Reef.
That's Reef picking and grinning their way into your hearts. I have to admit this morning, or yesterday morning as it is now, when I woke up in the caravan, rather dodgy caravan without proper stabilisers in another field, I was feeling really fed up. I was cold and covered in mud and homesick and so forth. And I went out and I was talking to some of the paying customers and I said to them, are you feeling as fed up as I am? And they were all going, no. And I said, why should we be fed up? And I said, well, all this mud. And they said, yeah, but it's only mud. And Jamie went out this morning as well and talked to some of the paying customers to find out what they were feeling.
great time.
We had a great time over there. It's 4 inches of water now, and up to really, up to here.
Michael, will the rain dampen the spirit of Glastonbury 97?
Not at all, not at all. There's a kind of Dunkirk spirit here. You know, when you're up against the wall, you know, we thrive, don't we?
Come down here, look, I found some people in their tent.
Look, hello, say hello. Hello.
It's damn cold and wet.
Now, are you enjoying yourselves?
Yes. Having a grand time.
A bit wet or a bit cold?
Totally soaking, there's ankle deep in mud. Completely marvellous.
This is what happens when you come to Glastonbury and you forget to bring your wellies.
Bless some little shoes.
Obviously, the weekend for you is just one big non-stop party, isn't it? You'd be dancing down the front and watching the bands.
We're kind of arguing about what show we're going to watch next. Terrorvision, and it's a Terrorvision tomorrow, so we'll try and get down there.
You're big Terrorvision fans?
Yeah, I am.
I'm just a little bit disappointed there's no Motown.
Really?
Yeah, because I really like Martha Rees and the Vandellas on my glass, but she's not on.
No, Martha couldn't make it this year, sadly. Listen, you need a middle pole here to join these bits together, don't you?
Earlier we did hold hands together and just have a little moment to ourselves, didn't we? But didn't do an awful lot of that.
This is a girls' tent.
Yes.
So you have a separate girls' tent and a separate boys' tent. That's very well behaved.
We're from Derry. We're from Derry.
Yes, you see, normally you're meant to be camping on ley lines. You're camping under electricity lines.
1971, we actually built this huge anti-rain gun. You know, it was like a great anti-aircraft sort of. It was on a pivot. Yeah, and we pointed it to the clouds, and we sent all this energy up the clouds.
And, did it work?
Well, kind of.
Sadly, there has been one casualty this weekend because of the weather. Very nasty.
You see, the sludge is affecting everything, even getting into Jamie's mouth at the beginning of that piece. Now, the mud as well is giving people a whole new game to play. You know, you like people who like chucking stuff at the stage when bands are playing. Well, Splatter the Pop Star is a popular game this weekend. And, of course, wearing dollops of mud on your shoulder just there is something that only Beck Hansen can carry off with any amount of style.
It's called One Foot in the Grave. It's five by the great harmonica player, Sonny Terry. Side. And on the other side, that's my folks.
Yeah, back there. That was definitely my folks. Oh yeah, and over in the back, that's all my folks. And what do you do when you find that you've been turned down? Stack it to the floor. Say, how did I get there? I gotta regulate. I got to regulate! My friends, what I gotta do? I gotta regulate! I gotta regulate! I gotta regulate! I gotta regulate! I gotta regulate!
Yeah.
Dancy wears it well. Only Beck could carry that off. That was Beck performing earlier on the main stage, the pyramid stage. This was at the time when all the rumours were going around. There's just been hundreds today. I think it's what's kind of kept people going throughout the day. There was a Radiohead have been trapped in their bus and it's sunk beneath the mud and taking them with them, so their performance was supposed to be off. And then Oasis apparently had booked a fleet of Winnebagoes and they were going to be here on Sunday, I think people were saying. But then the Winnebagoes were cancelled because it got really muddy. So nobody really knows what's going on. Are you comfortable there in your
chair?
I'm
very comfortable indeed.
I'm glad you are.
In case you've been wondering who the other cute guy with the beard is who's been cropping up in some of the films, that's Michael Eavis, and Glastonbury is his festival. In fact, the mud is his mud. Well, not all of it, because I've stolen some, put it in the boot of my car. But a couple of weeks ago, our mate Steve Lamacq interviewed him when the weather was still pretty good.
Few people could dream of inviting 100,000 people to their home for a weekend, but Michael Eavis is in a field of his own. When does the routine start to change from being the farm into being more of just a festival site?
Well, we're still running the farm now. We sent off some calves to the market this morning, actually. Yeah. We're still farmers at heart. You know, the farming's the main thing. But this is the exciting bit, though. It's really exciting, this sort of build-in, run into the event. You know, this sort of two-week period is absolutely fantastic. This country's full of artists, you know, and if you give them the tools and give them the stuff to do it with, then they can do wonders. Mm. We're terrific for arts and crafts, you know, and they really can do it, you know what I mean? And you'll see at the weekend, you'll see the structures that these people have actually put together, and it's something else. It's not like a rock and roll gig, this, you know, it's all about everything.
Mm. So also, do you think it's obviously looked at as a spiritual place, Glastonbury?
Well, spirituality is a bit vague, isn't it? I mean, we're all slightly hippie, you know. There's all the legends and all the mystic and all the King Arthur stuff and all that and the Holy Grail. That's all part of it, but it's all romantic, that. This is all for real. I don't like to dwell on that too much because it's sort of unsaid, you know, but it's recognised, but it's unsaid.
What makes you want to, you know, go through some of the aggravation of having a festival? Do you ever feel it's almost too much trouble? Because you must look at the fields and think, this is lovely.
Look, we've had some trouble in the past. We've had trouble with the convoy in the mid-80s. We had trouble with the council. I was in trouble with protesters in the village and things. And there's always something. There's always somebody grumbling. I've got eco-warriors at the moment complaining about the fence. And there's always something going on, you know. But there's always some aggro. But I think I do... I have to confess, I've got a slight addiction to it. To aggro and to... That being on the edge of some, slightly dangerous. Life before the festival was very cosy, milking cows and watching the grass grow and making hay and stuff. This is a bit more challenging, a bit more exciting. Where do you see rubbish bins like that? You wouldn't, would you? And that's just rubbish. So what am I here?
That's Glastonbury rubbish.
Yeah, absolutely. And what would you be doing, Hank, if you weren't here, Hank?
Working with them.
Would you?
Disabled people.
Oh, yeah.
Giving them art therapy.
Oh, lovely. Well done.
Are you a creative person?
I don't know. No, I just like what I see. I like this, you know, I like what I see. And then we encourage Hank, you know, give him a lot of support and everything. Woo-hoo! I'm the world's best expert, actually, at temporary loos.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I really am. Ray Brooks, actually, he's a dragon creator. Yeah. And he comes from East Anglia, and he comes every year, and he does something special for us. And this was probably the most special thing he's ever done. So we all love the dragon. It's become a bit of a landmark now. It's very well done. It's absolutely delightful. It's a real joy for us.
What does the rest of the family do while?
Well, all the kids come back for it. They all get involved, you know. They get involved with this, that, and the other. My youngest daughter's actually painting the barrels this morning. I mean, they all get involved. They might not come home for Christmas, but they all come home for the festival, you know, always do.
Tell us about some of your highlights over the years. When I mentioned Oasis to you earlier on, you glowed.
It's great to see the boys get on so well, because we had them here 3-4 years ago and they were good, and we could see that they were good, and suddenly they were world leaders, and I feel a lot of it happened here, you know, and I feel really pleased about it.
Do you think one of the reasons that this has lasted so long is you're kind of a resilient sort of character.
Resilient to criticism, resilient to the problems and to crises and things. And I can always see at the end of all, I can always see a light at the end of it all. And there's like a dream, you know, really. And it's like fulfilling all your dreams at the festival. Right? So many aspects of people's aspirations that they can fulfill here, you know. And providing you see that sort of flame at the end of all this darkness and things, you see that light through the tunnel, and it keeps you going, and you're always striving for it all the time. And sometimes it gets wet or it gets murky, and you know, you get a little bit of trouble, and you get the council putting the boot in, and all that. But there's always something beyond, you know, that sort of shines forth that, but you can look forward to.
It's really fantastically comfortable on this chair, I want you to know that. That was our mate Steve Lamack talking to Michael Eavis, and Steve is at this very moment somewhere out on the camps, out in this area, talking to the Orb and Dread Zone for tomorrow night's programme.
It's very funny you should mention that, actually. This whole place has been kind of transformed into this cult of children's TV, and it's just like Teletubby land. Everyone's walking around going, Dipsy, Popo, La La, Tinky Winky. But we'll put that down to medication, I think. This next band came on at just the right moment. It was kind of getting a bit bleak, and everyone needed their spirits lifting, and then Supergrass came on, and they did it. This is In It For The Money. You can hear more Supergrass tomorrow if you haven't had enough so far. I think it's going to be my show on Radio 1. That will be between 12:30 and 3 o'clock.
It could very possibly be on mine, and I'm not absolutely certain when that is. Something like 3
no,
to 6.
No, I definitely put a bid in for Supergrass.
3 That's to 6, amazing. I think it is, anyway. And the Smashing Pumpkins coming up in just a moment. And one of the rumours that we heard in the morning, there were many rumours going around, as Joe's pointed out, was that they were going to play in, like, tangerine posing pouches or bondage gear or something like that. Rather disappointingly, they did nothing of the sort.
Thankfully.
By starlight, kiss you and promise to me you're one and only. And I'll make you happy and leave you to be lovely, lost in my life. And where will we go?
Yeah.
I think the one thing that made that so riveting, that performance, was knowing that Billy Corgan probably did have a tangerine posing pouch on underneath his black trousers.
That tie's good, though, isn't it? I can see Alan
it's
Hansen.
Horrible, it's so hideous.
I can see Alan Hansen in that.
Yeah.
The next thing we have for you is a lovingly made film about Glastonbury past, and it's going to be introduced by absolutely my favourite broadcaster.
I am going a long way with these thou seest, if indeed I go, for all my mind is clouded with a doubt, to the island valley of Avilion.
Glastonbury is steeped in a magical history. For some, it's the mythical island of Avalon and the resting place of King Arthur. For others, it's the site of pilgrimage just 50 miles from sacred Stonehenge. Many more know it as the annual Dansatious Mud Bar, founded in Flower Power, and the best reason for investing in a tent in the 1990s.
Free lovemaking, the fertility rites, the naked dancing, and most of all, the drug taking.
I wouldn't say a disaster, but it hasn't been as good as I'd hoped.
What did you really hope for?
How many people? I thought we'd get about 5,000, and we didn't really have about a couple of thousand.
On that land and you're not going down there. That vehicle's sitting there. There's no vehicle right away. That's a bridle bar.
Basically, we've had to step up the number of officers that we engage at this festival simply because it has grown in size and simply to reassure the local residents.
The moon is running red. Boy, boy, it's
the festival is CND's largest single fundraiser. Its organiser has been warned, if there's any trouble this year, he'll never again be given permission to hold Europe's largest open-air music festival.
Well, how can you close the monument? It doesn't belong to anybody.
National Heritage have closed the monument.
For some people, though, it's not so strict. The rule seems to be, if you don't look like a hippie, you can see the stones. If you do, you can't.
Stonehenge has been a temple, an observatory and a tourist attraction. Today, fenced in by wire and court orders, it's a fortress.
The farmer who's holding a pop festival near Glastonbury next week today won a high court injunction against nearly 100 hippies camped on his land.
Wind fanned the flames which destroyed the best-known symbol of the festival.
Four people have been treated in hospital for gunshot wounds after a man fired a semi-automatic pistol at the Glastonbury Music Festival.
It's almost impossible, a logistical impossibility to stop and search everybody.
But now the power of the wind is being harnessed all to the good. It isn't only the stage that's making good use of the Earth's natural energy. Elsewhere, the wind and the sun are powering mobile phones, a festival radio station, and a circus top.
We'll have a break. We're going to do some different things. We're going to Vietnam, for instance. See what Oxfam have done with all the money that they've raised and things. So I mean, we've got a lot to do. You know, we can take a year off, can't we? I'm 60 years old now, you know, retirement age.
Evis Michael, 10,204.
Widening roads and strengthening bridges on this site is all part of Michael Evis's plans to increase the size of the festival this year to 100,000.
I live a really uncomplicated, happy, content sort of life. But one of the few problems that I do have is that every once in a while, in fact, rather too frequently, people come up to me and say, I remember you from the whistle test. And I always say, no, that was Bob Harris. I never did the whistle test. And another problem I have is that everybody thinks that I went to every Glastonbury that ever there was. I went to the very first one, although Michael Eavis denies that I did. I don't know how he knows that, but he says I didn't go. And then to about the last five or six. But I think I shall carry on going to them for a few more years, yeah.
Was John Craven at the one that you went to?
Alas, he wasn't. No, he wasn't. I've modelled
but
my
he is
career.
A close personal friend,
yeah, he
obviously.
Is, actually, yes. I've modelled my career on his.
Okay, Glastonbury obviously is huge and absolutely vast. There's so much going on. And this year it's particularly difficult to get to see absolutely everything because it's so slow going with all the mud that's around. And I was over at the Jazz stage earlier on watching Massive Attack. They were just about to go on stage. And someone loitering in the background was Michael Franti of Spearhead and formerly of the Disposable Heroes of Hypocrisy. And we got him in here earlier on to perform a special acoustic set for us. This is Michael Franti.
Yes, yes, y'all, this is the Microscope, Michael Franti here, coming at you directly from Glastonbury. I'm still out here trying to find the Glastonburys. I was out there trying to find something to make a little jam out of, but all I got was my knees full of mud. But y'all gonna kick this piece for you. Well, lose your mind, misplace your mind, forgot you even had a mind, because someone told you it's impossible to change your mind. A friend of mine made it to 25. We had a celebration. Man, I'm glad that you're alive. I'm happy to see my man, you're beating the odds. And for this, on this day, we give thanks to the gods, because everyone deserves a shot, but you only get one. I hope it's not through the head, my son. Because life is short. When you're afraid to cry, life is hard. When you're afraid to die. But when I feel alone, I sing myself a song, because wherever I lay a groove is my home. But can you see me in the desert? Of course you can. And can you see me on the mountain? Of course you can. And can you see me in the ocean? Of course you can. I'm just splishing, splashing, jumping in the sand. But he remembered memories of walking through the puddle saying, gee, Dad, am I the one who's wanted by the federal government? Doesn't want me to go to school? I ask too many questions, and I don't play by their rules. In school, they tried to tell me that a rock was not alive, but I've seen a volcano growing up and die. In school, they tried to tell me a tree it couldn't feel, but I felt a tree and it was bleeding for real. In school, they tried to tell me animals couldn't talk, but they could understand it when my dog starts to bark. In school, they tried to tell me man doesn't have a soul. What happened to his, I say, because mine is still whole. But can you see me in the desert? Of course you can. And can you see me on the mountain? Of course you can. And can you see me in the ocean? Of course you can. I'm just splishing, splashing, jumping in the sand. With a reoccurring dream of a life's imprisonment, the reoccurring scream of a world and its residents, the reoccurring theme of a mind full of fingerprints, the reoccurring dream of a knife and a president. Would you like to look at Madonna's book on sex? Or would you rather Alex Haley's book on Malcolm X? They're messing with Ice-T, but they don't even care if Eric Clapton singing, I shot the sheriff. But how many more books on the subject can I read? And how many more frustrations must I try to ease? And how many more days of this bad air can I breathe? And how many more of my friends must just die and leave? But you can't defuse the ticking time bomb, and you can't refuse the time it has come. And you can't erase my people from the nation. We'll take a life before you call us the lost generation. But can you see us in the desert? Of course you can. And can you see us on the mountain? Of course you can. And can you see us in the ocean? Of course you can. We're just splishing, splashing, jumping in this. And can you see us on the mountain? Of course you can. Can you see us in the desert? Of course you can. And can you see us in Glastonbury? Of course you can. We're just splishing, splashing with mud in our hands. Peace.
What a star. He's such a formidable character. That's Michael Franti from Spearhead. And I think they're singing Downtown in the background. Our special reserve of wine has arrived, so it's about time for us to leave you. And Jane Middlemiss and Jamie Thixton will be back with you tomorrow on BBC Two at 11:45. We've got radio shows to do tomorrow as well, bringing you more from Glastonbury. And then there's tomorrow night as well.
There is, yes. Joe and I will be back tomorrow night at 11 o'clock and we'll be introducing more live music and bits and pieces. And also showing you how to make... showing you how to make a model of the main stage out of egg boxes and old toilet rolls. But that's it for night, so good night to you. And we're going to leave you with more uproar from The Prodigy.